Good morning, Bethel, and I want to just welcome you to a Pentecost service today. Happy day of Pentecost. Could you greet the folk, you in the room? Come on, make some noise. Good morning. This is the 50th day. This marks the end of the disciples' in-between period. From the ascension of our Lord into heaven to the day the Spirit of God came into his earthly ministry, God the Holy Ghost, on the day of Pentecost, came into his earthly ministry. And they were all with one accord, the scripture says. 120 of them in the upper room. When the Lord ascended, he left them discombobulated in between. They were not where they had been walking in the ministry of Jesus, and they were told to wait and tarry. And some of you, my in-between brethren, you're waiting for the in-between liminal season to end. You're waiting for the circularity to end so that you can launch forth in a straight line of conquest. Well, this is the best day. I let the Lord know it would certainly reflect well on him if he poured his Spirit out upon us today. Amen. Can you be in agreement with that? Where he will confirm the word today with signs following. And do I have a delicious assignment this morning? You know, I don't know about you, but I love to name things. When I can name things in my life, I can have authority over them. And today we're going to do a lot of naming concerning this great outpouring of God's Spirit that is just ahead of us. We're standing on the brink of the greatest outpouring of God in human history, and what a day to celebrate it. This morning, my assignment is entitled Samuel's In Between. Well, if you've been with us for any period of time, you know that I love to use people as representative of moves of God. We've all heard about the Joshua generation, how that Moses, his servant, died, and Joshua led them from circularity into a straight line of conquest. And then we've talked about Jonathan's, John, who wrote the Gospel of John, and the epistles of John, and the book of Revelation. Of all the thousands, Jesus picked 70. Out of the 70, he picked 12. Out of the 12, he picked 3. And out of the 3, John was his best friend. He called himself the disciple whom Jesus loved. And in John, we see that rare blend of tenderness and literacy. And he was the one that would lay on the Lord's chest at night during dinner and hear the heartbeat of the God-man. He was his best friend. And boy, John's represent those remnant folk that are wanting all that God can give. And they are the best friends of Jesus. And so you can go back in our archive and read about John. And then we looked at Nathanael. Oh, that was a good message. Nathanaels are those who are witty and bright and gifted and talented and cutting edge and educated. And Nathanael, Jesus saw him walking towards him, and he said to Nathanael, "Behold, an Israelite in whom there's no Jacob at all." He had no untoward ambition. Nathanael was childlike in all of his ways, and he represented in the message I gave on Nathanael's just a great description of the men, women, boys, and girls that I believe are going to be running around in the kingdom. So we're going to run into our Johns, and we're going to run into our Nathanaels, but this morning I want to introduce you to the Samuels in between. We're going to look at the life of the prophet Samuel. Now, remember, we're in a series called In Between. We're talking about liminal space. Liminal space. What is that? Well, when you leave one state of affairs, you are immediately like you have a loss in your life or a promotion when you graduate from school or when you get married. There are certain moments in life where the end is that what you were in is over and you are thrust in between for a season of time. You're not where you were. You're not quite walking through the new door that is to open. That's called liminal space, in-between space. And in-between is where you are transformed. In-between is where that little creature becomes a butterfly. In-between time is a reality in our lives, and some of us have lived in-between for decades. You're not quite where you were, and you're not quite where you're going to be, and you're sort of stuck in between. Well, we can look at the whole Bible through a liminal lens. But some of my favorite in-betweeners, and I got to tell you, Samuel is my favorite. Remember Noah? Clearly. One world was washed away. He is placed in the ark for a year, and that's a liminal space. He's in between. Pretty smelly in there, Tom. Sometimes liminal space can stink a little bit too. But he clearly was a liminal leader because he left the old world, went into the ark in between, and then finally the ark landed. It didn't crash. It landed on the mountain range of Ararat. And the scripture says as the waters receded, the whole new world was opened up for him. He's a liminal man. And you know Moses. God called him to lead the children of Israel out of Egypt, and then they were thrust in between for 40 years of circularity, where God sorted everything out, and then they led. They were led by Joshua into the straight line of conquest, the land of Canaan. Moses was a liminal man. But I want to look at Samuel, because to me, Samuel strikes me. He was the last judge of a period of over 300 years called the time of the judges. Remember, Moses led them out, and there were 40 years in the wilderness, and Moses dies, and then Joshua takes them into the land, and yet they're led after Joshua's death by a series, about 13, 14 judges, they're called, and Samuel is the last of the judges. So he stood between one epic of God's work in the world and the kings he would soon anoint. This man is a liminal man. This man is Mr. In-Between. Don't mess with Mr. In-Between. This guy is one of the most gifted and talented leaders, but he is most known for his character. And how many of you know God wants not Samson's example to be our example? He wants Samuel's example to be our example. He started well, he held in, and he finished well. And I believe the traits of Samuel, I'm going to stretch out into the Samuels that you're going to start seeing emerge. And we're going to look at the traits of Samuel the prophet, and we're going to apply those traits to the Samuels that are going to be in the ministry. Most of them are hidden right now. They're still in between. But don't worry. You'll know them when you see them. Just as clearly as the Bible says, from Dan to Beersheba, universally in Israel, everyone knew Samuel. Everyone knew he was a man of integrity. And the scripture says he was so balanced in his ministry that not one arrow he shot didn't hit the bullseye. Not one spear he threw fell short of the bullseye. This man was a respected, meal and oil, word and spirit man. And he served 80 years with integrity, and he finished well. Amen? Doesn't matter how you started, you can finish well. So let me get to it, because I'm so excited, I might just overshoot. I heard a theologian was asked, sir, do you think the Pentecostals are going to make it to heaven? He said, if they don't overshoot it. Psalm 99, verses 6 and 7, Moses and Aaron were among his priests. Samuel was among those who called on his name. They called on the Lord, and he answered them. He spoke to them from the pillar of cloud. They kept his statutes and the decrees he gave them. Samuel is put on equal par with Moses. Moses, Aaron, and Samuel. That's a triumvirate. This guy is placed next to Moses himself as one of the greatest prophets that ever lived. But oh, wait, 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 because we're going to find out Samuel and all of God's Samuels wear multiple hats and flow in multiple areas of ministry. We'll get there in a minute, but we're looking at the life of Samuel. And I want to, for our text, if you would just let me minister this verse to you. It's extended, 1 Samuel 7, 1 through 17. But I just want you to just let the flavor of this settle in your mouth. Listen to the points we run into concerning Samuel. And by the way, he was the last of the judges, he was the first of the prophets, and he after that period of judges, God saved the best for last. Did you know he likes to do that? Remember the wine at the wedding of Cana? Thou hast saved the best for last. Samuel was the best judge there ever was in that tumultuous period of Israel's history. And he was the first of the prophets. From Moses until him, not many mentions of the prophetic. But with Samuel begins a well-balanced wholeness of ministry, of accuracy and world renown that it's shattering to see such a faithful soul. So I want you to be encouraged. Listen to this. So the men of Kirjath-Jearim came and took up the ark of the Lord. They brought it to Abinadab's house on the hill. They consecrated Eleazar, his son, to guard the ark of the Lord. The ark remained at Kirjath-Jearim a long time, 20 years in all. 20 years is a long time. Some of you have been waiting a long time in between, but hold on, don't worry, hold on. Then all the people of Israel turned back to the Lord. During this long period of 20 years, the children of Israel began to yearn for the Lord. Their hearts were ripening in hunger and thirst for the things of God. So Samuel said to the Israelites, he strikes while the iron's hot. He says, if you are returning to the Lord with all your hearts, then rid yourselves of the foreign gods and the Ashtoreths and commit yourself to the Lord and serve him only, and he will deliver you out of the hand of the Philistines. So the Israelites put away their Baals and their Ashtoreths, and they served the Lord only. Then Samuel said, assemble all Israel at Mizpah. I will intercede with you, to the Lord for you. When they had assembled at Mizpah, they drew water and poured it out before the Lord. On that day they fasted, and there they confessed, we have sinned against the Lord. Now Samuel was serving the leader of Israel at Mizpah. And when the Philistines heard that Israel had assembled at Mizpah, the rulers of the Philistines came up to attack them. When the Israelites heard of it, they were afraid because of the Philistines. They said to Samuel, do not stop crying out to the Lord our God for us, that he may rescue us from the hands of the Philistines. Listen, then Samuel took a sucking lamb, sacrificed it as a whole burnt offering to the Lord. He cried out to the Lord on Israel's behalf, and the Lord answered him. While Samuel was sacrificing the burnt offering, the Philistines drew near to engage Israel in battle. But that day the Lord thundered with a loud thunder against the Philistines and threw them into such a panic that they were routed before the Israelites. The men of Israel rushed out of Mizpah, pursued the Philistines, slaughtered them along the way to the point of Beth-Kar. Then Samuel took a stone and set it up between Mizpah and Shen. He named it Ebenezer, saying, thus far the Lord has helped us. It means the stone of help. So the Philistines were subdued. Listen to this, verse 13. So the Philistines were subdued, and they stopped invading Israel's territory throughout Samson's lifetime. The hand of the Lord was against the Philistines. The towns from Ekron to Gath that the Philistines had captured from Israel were restored to Israel, and Israel delivered the neighboring territory from the hands of the Philistines, and there was peace between Israel and the Amorites. And Samuel continued as Israel's leader all the days of his life. From year to year, he went on a circuit from Bethel to Gilgal to Mizpah, judging Israel in all those places. But he always went back to Ramah, where his home was, and there he held court for Israel, and he built an altar unto the Lord. May God bless the reading of his holy word. This is an introduction to the greatest in-between leader, I believe, in the Bible. And I believe we can seize upon him and the traits of his ministry to accurately name the men, women, boys, and girls who are just about to emerge on the world scene. And oh, my Lord, are they pregnant with purpose? And they're right on time. Loved one, God is early, but he's never late. He's never early, but he's never late. He's always right on time. And we always think, well, I need to get out of this cocoon. I'm going to die in this cocoon. You just wait. Just wait. You'll come out. And you need the struggle in order to develop those wings that are going to transform you and the lives of others. So in between time must be stewarded appropriately. And we must allow God to bring us full term in the pregnancy so that we don't come out premature and messed up. God's timing is perfect. So look at Samuel and his corresponding Samuels. Samuels have unusual births. And I want to encourage you, everything in your life has been ordered by God for this season. 1 Samuel chapter 1 says that Samuel's mother Hannah was barren. The Lord had closed her womb. And you know, for a season of time, sometimes God closes your womb. It's not the devil, it's God, because he wants you to bear a prophet. Women who were barren knew only God could reverse their situation. And she longed for a son. and she longed for a man child, and he was well longed for. And I want to tell you, you say, well, Craig, I was an accident. There's no such thing in the kingdom of God. You were wanted and desired by God. You're not here because of a fluke. Well, we weren't expecting. Well, maybe they weren't expecting, but God was expecting you. As he said to Jeremiah the prophet, I foreknew you before you were conceived in the womb, and I set you apart in your mother's womb, and I called you to bless your generation. So Samuel was desired. He was sought after. Samuels have unusual births. Everything in your history, everything in your pedigree has been the direct hand of God sculpting you to be who you are, matching the man or the woman with the mission. God knows how to match a man with his moment. And he just can't be forced. Have you figured that out? You know, when you try to force things and help God out, Abraham tried to help him out, gave birth to Ishmael. Every time you get in the flesh and try to help poor, dumb God out, you birth something that just causes conflict 2,000, 3,000 years later. So, God's more than capable of promising and then performing his promises. Just wanted to throw that in for free because it's Pentecost. The tongues of fire are coming. All right, good. Samsons have unusual births. Secondly, Samsons are raised in unusual times. Did you know that God sends, when there's a problem, he sends a baby? Lord, you should send an army. Oh, no, no, no. Lincoln was in a town once and he said, to the guy, first guy, so I said, is there any famous people born in this town? And the guy said, no, only babies. Only babies? When God wanted to change the world and deliver his people from Egypt, he sent a baby floating in a little ark. Samsons are born in the most unusual times. First, they emerge in the midst of national catastrophes. Let me tell you a little something about the time he was born into. Oh, when was the young prophet born who would be the greatest in-between leader of all time? In the midst of national catastrophe. The priesthood was corrupt, 1 Samuel 2. Completely corrupt. The ark was absent from the tabernacle. That means the glory wasn't there. And the scripture says the word of the Lord was rare in those days. Rare as hen's teeth. So we're talking about a nasty time. It's like, well, God, I mean, he loves to send a baby that's the answer. And by the way, we're going to look at his mama in just a minute because this great judge, prophet, seer, Levite, Nazirite, he wore so many hats, and he wore them well, had a praying mama. Did you know Samuels always have prayer warriors called to match their ministry? We'll look at his mom in a minute. This woman could pray heaven and earth slapped together. She could pray like Kim with her Thor hammer prayers. There's certain folk you want praying for you when you're in trouble. You know what I mean? You don't go to the sappy Kool-Aid people. You know, I'll pray for you, Father. Our prayers are with you. Thanks. All the power of a mother-in-law's kiss. It's Pentecost. Let him have a little moment of joke. All right. So the priesthood is corrupt. The ark is not in the tabernacle. Idols are worshipped, 1 Samuel chapter 7. And the judges are all dishonest, 1 Samuel chapter 8. He is born in an unusual time that you would not associate with glory. So take heart. Every age thinks they live in the most wicked age. Why, we live in a wicked age. I was reading a quote from the 18th century. Wickedness has never been so deep and ingrained in the culture. Nonsense. Every generation is a wicked generation, the Bible says. So don't think. I mean, when the angels were singing over the earth at the birth of the God-man, Rome is in charge, crushing the earth with its iron heel. So don't you think your time, well, our times are really dark. Of course, because the prince of the power of the air is the Lord of darkness. Nothing has changed. We just see it all quicker. There's no more sin than has ever been in the culture. We just got more folk to do it, and we're watching it in social media 24 hours a day. Oh, my God, what's happened to the culture? That's been going on from the time Adam and Eve fell. Huh? It's just more visible to you to see. You used to have to wait till it shot up in the newspapers 2 weeks later. All right? So watch what your little ears are hearing and your little eyes are watching all the time. Shut the noise out. That's free. Your little tongues of fire. Free. All right. They have unusual births, and those Samuels that are being raised up, every part of their pedigree, every part of their family history, every part of their family of origin, all the screw-ups, all the addiction, all the demons in the closet, all the sexual perversion that came from grandpa to papa and to you, these things are going to be broken. But God will redeem them and turn them into the you you need to be. It's not about the destination. It's about the journey you've been on. Why, I thought I'd be in a different destination when I grew up. I didn't know I'd be here. God did, and thank God for it, because the journey has made you you, and you don't need to be anyone else. This is not a Samuels don't imitate anybody. Anybody. They are so unique in between. This guy wore so many hats, it was confusing to watch him shift gears from each ministry anointing he had to another, and he did it with excellence. He wasn't perfect, but he was excellent. And he made it all the way through. Isn't it comforting? If you read 1 Samuel 12, when he rehearses, looks through the rearview mirror, he says, who have I defrauded? Whose donkey have I stolen? Who did I take a bribe from to pervert justice? And the whole nation said, you haven't, your hands are clean. He goes, good. Now, he did have two miserable kids. That's a point we'll get to later. Because, you know, you can't control anything outside your own choices and thoughts. Did you know that, moms and dads? Good people have wicked kids, and wicked people have good kids, and you cannot. You can manage them when they're babies, but when they come of age and of moral accountability, they can become a Buddhist, they can become an atheist, they can fly off to the moon. Yet the scripture did not blame Samuel at all for the choices that his siblings made, but that's a premature point. It comes later. All right, they have unusual births, unusual times are the context. And loved one, the third point is Samuels have unusual training. Samuels are usually raised around unfaithful priests and leaders. Why? Eli, the priest, is a fat, old, blind man. His sons, Hophni and Phinehas, are sleeping with all the women at the door of the tabernacle, and they're stealing the offerings illicitly. They're eating God's portion of the peace offerings. They're dogs. And there they are in the tabernacle, and everything externally seems to be going on, but internally they're completely corrupt. Now, Hannah has her baby. She weans him, and as a little lad, she takes him into the tabernacle, the place of worship, and there's Eli the priest, and she commends Samuel into the care of this short-sighted priest, who, by the way, gets a word from the Lord that he and his family will die and his priesthood would be severed forever in Israel. Isn't that a lovely word to get prophetically? I got a beautiful word for you. You're all going to die. Hallelujah. I'm going to cut root and branch your whole priesthood out. Why would God allow these fallen, broken people to mentor and raise Samuel? Because God is not as afraid to risk as we are. He knows contrast is the best teacher. Isn't that true? Moses learned how not to be a leader watching Pharaoh. He didn't judge him. He just said, when I'm in charge, I can't do that. I call this section, Others May, You May Not. Well, how come, Mama, they all get to go? Others may. You may not. But the statistics are, well, that's the is-ought fallacy. People is doing certain things, but ought they do them? That's a different question. You know, 59.5 of the population is thus and so, fill in the blank. Well, that's nice. That's what they is doing. Ought they do it? Hell no. When you get that stupid 2% of the population to vote your way politically, where your little issue gets to be 51%, and now what was illegal yesterday is legal today, or what was immoral yesterday is now moral, does a head count? decide whether 2 plus 2 is 4?
Well, the majority, 99.9 of our culture believes 2 plus 2 is 6. Bless your heart.
Did you know truth is truth? True truth. Belief doesn't make anything true. We can get 50 million Germans support Hitler. Okay. Well, we did the head count. Seems pretty thorough. That's what they is doing. Ought they have done that? Of course not. You go, oh, no. Morals don't change because the head count changes. That's a fallacy, by the way. If I can count enough people to believe some stupid thing, 2 plus 2 is 5. Does that make it 5? Belief doesn't make true truth. Truth is truth, whether you believe it or not. Well, I refuse to believe 2 plus 2 is 4. Okay, good for you. You don't get to that with a head count. Amen. That's all free too.
Tongues of fire.
All right. So, I mean, it's a horrible time, and the leaders are corrupt, and Samuel is thrown right in the middle of it. Contrast teaches you. David learned how not to be king serving under Saul. Contrast. Contrast. Straight pool cue, crooked pool cue. Lean it against the wall. A 5-year-old will see it every time. You don't need to argue logically about that. Here are 17 irrefutable arguments that is the straight pool cue, and that is the crooked pool cue. You don't need to do that. Lay them up, and the kid will grab the straight one because they don't want the crooked one. Amen? Because God, we're made in the image of God, the Imago Dei. We know things. Have you ever figured out where you got that? Where did you get the image of crooked and straight? Did you learn that in school? Did you get born a tabula rasa, a blank slate, and somehow a teacher taught you? No. You conceptually know what's crooked and what's straight. You already have that. You wouldn't even know what crooked is unless you knew what straight was. When atheists use the problem of evil to disprove God, they've made a horrible mistake because you don't even know what evil is unless you're measuring it against the standard of absolute truth. So you got to posit God to say anything is wrong. It may be uncomfortable. I mean, right may be uncomfortable, but to call it wrong, is it really wrong to torture a child for fun? Well, you're never going to get an atheist to agree with you, of course. But their worldview can't support that. Because what more evolved primates do to one another is really neither here nor there. It's not moral at all. How is it that we know that's evil? Well, how do you know what evil is? Because you're presupposing an absolute good, namely God. So evil proves there's a devil. That's all it proves. It doesn't disprove God. Dumbest thing you could do is bring up evil to refute the existence of God, because you're assuming God in order to measure that as better or best, right or wrong. C.S. Lewis points that out in Mere Christianity. He said, I was an atheist, but atheists must be very careful about their reading, because he started reading some non-kosher, non-atheistic material, and Lewis went, wait a minute, why am I calling something just or unjust unless I already know intuitively that there is an absolute justice against which I'm weighing everything else? Tongues of fire. All right, that's free. They'll know us in the streets, won't they? They're from Bethel, aren't they? So God will use contrast to teach character. Now, I want you to notice something. Samuel has a contemporary, and his name is Samson. They were in ministry at the same time, overlap, like by 8 years. Okay? Now, we've taught on Samson many times and demonstrated that God's emphasis for him was not so much the immorality, but that he wanted the Philistines compromised and destroyed. Correct. But he was an immoral man. That's true. And he got some consequences. That's true. And during his reign as a judge, he never conquered the Philistines completely. He killed more in his death than he had in his life, but the tide wasn't stemmed until Samuel. Samuel, the meal and oil, word and spirit, balanced, word man, theologically educated, double dose of the Holy Ghost all over him. That guy, during all the days of his life, the Philistines were helpless, powerless, and totally contained. And their other enemy, the Amorites, had peace with them. There's something about the Samuel anointing that brings complete deliverance. That's what you're going to see in Samuel's. Men, women, boys, and girls alike, they're going to have anointings that are going to hit the target. 1 Samuel chapter 3 says not one word he ever spoke fell to the ground. That means when he gave a prophetic word, the spear hit the bullseye every time. When he gave a prophetic pronouncement, the arrow hit the bullseye every time. Not once did it fall short. And everyone knew it, from Dan to Beersheba. That's like from California to New York. Universally, Samuels are known to bear God's hand, and they are so unique in their giftings that they hit the bullseye. They're not perfect, but their hearts are perfect before God. And God likes them. You heard me say it. God loves everyone equally. He doesn't like everyone equally. God, no. Nor do you. Nor should you. Think of someone in your family that you love but you do not like. And spending 5 minutes with them is like sitting on a grill. Doesn't take long. You're finished. Now, cakes are done. People are finished. Yeah. Okay. Tell you. All right. So, let me continue. I'm so pregnant with this thing, I don't want to overshoot the kingdom. This is the day of Pentecost, beloved. This is the 50th day. This signals the day that the 120 in the upper room left their in-between status, their liminal space, and they finally left the circularity and they went in a straight line of conquest and changed the world. And they multiplied like rabbits. My friend George Barner wrote a book called The Elephant and the Rabbit. And his point is, mega churches are like elephants. It's virtually impossible for them to reproduce healthily. You can leave them alone. You can do anything. They just rarely reproduce. But rabbits, you just turn your back and get some tea and come back, and they've already multiplied. So God in the future, small is the new big. Coming into this outpouring of the Holy Spirit. There's nothing wrong with big. There's nothing wrong with elephants. God bless them all. We want public meetings. The book of Acts had public meetings and home meetings. This is not either or, it's both and. But you're going to see a signature of the Samuels is going to be rabbit-like multiplication. We don't want addition. Yeah. We beg for addition. Our prayers involve addition. Lord, please add. I don't want addition. I want multiplication. That's what I want. Pray for multiplication for me. Save that addition for your father. Prayer people. That could be the little soundtrack in the background while they're all sleeping. A Jason Upton song and they all. All right. Next, listen to this. Samuels are usually called to shepherd people who have gotten what they wanted but now have leanness in their souls. Ooh. Oh, what a congregation of idiots. Remember? Psalm 106:15. So he gave them what they asked for and sent a wasting disease among them, sent leanness into their soul. Have you ever had to minister to people that have leanness in their soul? Moses did for 40 years. 100 funerals a day for 40 years till they're all dropped dead. This was not a perky crowd for this brilliant prophet, judge, Levite, seer, judge. I said that. He's wearing so many hats and he's wearing them well, but do you think he's got a cheering crowd that's behind him? Amen, come on, no. These are all people that after all the excellence in Samuel's ministry still want a king. We want to be like the other nations and reject God as our king, and we want a king just like them. And Samuel goes, what? Leanness of heart people. Leanness of soul people always want to look like the world. We want someone to like tell us where to go and what to do. And Samuel says, well, you have God Almighty, the triune, holy, the thrice holy God. No, we want like an Ayatollah Khomeini. We want like Saddam Hussein. We want a Hitler. Oh, my God. If you ever want to see Samuel's grief, they grieve at this point because their congregations are suffering with leanness. It's always Doug and Debbie Weiner. How are you? I don't know. It's just the sky is falling. Well, we all go through that sometimes, but all the time, every time we talk to you, you're always, well, I'm in the valley, and I don't know if I'll ever get out. Oh, my God. I've got a great church to send you to across the street. That was Samuel's crowd. So hey, you perky little Samuels, with all your gifts, talents, abilities, and multiple hat wearing, don't expect you're going to have a mob of positive folks. That takes discipline. That means you show up at the pulpit like Jeremiah chapter 1, and God said, neither be afraid of their faces. Jeremiah had an amazing ministry. His ministry was to say, you're hopeless, you're helpless, you're going into captivity, you're going to lose your temple, your children are going to be dragged off in chains, and there's no way you can stop this. That was Jeremiah's positive ministry. Super good and getting better. All right. And false prophets came along and said, no, God would never destroy his temple or take his people out. And God said, I didn't send them. They're liars. I sent Jeremiah. Jeremiah had a 50-year ministry, okay, of saying super bad and getting worse. That was his word of faith stance. And they hated his guts. He said, look, I'm not trying to rain on your parade, but you're going bye-bye. And guess what? I've got great news. What is it? The Babylonians are going to come and flay you alive and your kids. That's hard to do that for 50 years, isn't it? You imagine the poor guy. He's the guy that said, Lord, you tricked me into serving you. I wish I had a motel out in the woods where I could live a normal life. Yeah, he's a trickster sometimes. I agree. But Samuel had somewhat of that when he looked at the lean crowd, you know. Do you have any macaroni and cheese? No, we don't. It's Wood Ranch. No, you know what I mean. It's just always, I don't know. How was your steak? Did you like Gone with the Wind? I've seen better. You notice how people that are lean people, they can level anything. You say something nice about Dennis. I love that Dennis Haggard. Yeah, well, I know some things about Dennis. What? Whiners. You can neutralize anyone with a, Do you like Pastor Craig's ministry? Yeah, he's very clownish and immature, and I don't like that when he does things like that. Well, you're right about that, but God called me. Tough. All right. Samuels are usually called to shepherd people who have gotten what they wanted and now have leanness in their soul. Listen to this one. Samuels have a unique circuit of ministry that occupies their time and wisdom while they wait for their reformation. Notice it says that he had a cycle he went to. He went to Gilgal and he went to Bethel and he went to... He had a little circle where he was, while he was waiting, because it was 20 years. Once they lost the ark to the Philistines and got it back, it was in the house of Abinadab 20 years. That's a long time. I'm glad even God acknowledged that in his word. A long time. A long time with Samuel all ready to go, Mr. Faithful, and he had to wait because the sins of others put him in a season where he had to do the next right thing. And you know what he did? Bless his heart. He made sure he went to all the faraway places in Israel where normally preachers wouldn't go, teachers wouldn't go, prophets wouldn't go, Levites wouldn't go. He went. He said, you know what? It's going to be a long time before that ark comes back and they have any thirst for it. So I'm not going to sit around and get depressed and go to therapy. I'm going to start a circuit where they get used to seeing me consistently, where he took his wisdom and his counsel and his insight and his anointing everywhere he could go to the uttermost to bless the people until the Reformation started, right? Well, they were in the 120 were in the upper room. I mean, they weren't running around doing missions work, but they were praying, and they were being together in communitas. See, we were revisiting communitas because there was so much communitas under Samuel's ministry that the enemies were stopped. They just weren't there. You know, people say, what? Oh, heaven's going to be so wonderful. There's no devils there. Yeah, but we're not there yet. So God wants to send up his anointed Samuels to quell the enemy enough that we have a space of peace in between. Amen? There's a lot of noise out there, but when you come in here, you're supposed to come into a circle of communitas where there's rest, peace, refreshment. In fact, people should come into your presence and feel communitas, rest, peace, and refreshment. Rather than after 5 minutes of you, they're going out going, oh, Lord God, I'm exhausted. I have to pray for 3 days to get back up to where I was when she called. Please don't be that person. Amen. And all those people are saying, who's he talking about? You know who you are. I remember an old Gary Shandling joke where he said, I saw two ugly people kissing the other day, and I just said, cut it out. And he said, you know who you are. Stop it. Stop it. Gretchen's back in the house, y'all. Lincoln's riding out on his horse once, and a little girl comes up and goes, sir, I believe you're the ugliest man I've ever seen in my life. And he says, well, honey, there's not much I could do about that. She says, you could have stayed home. Listen, Samuel's next trait. Samuels are surrounded, even in their own families, by those who do not choose to walk with the Lord as they do. Beloved, Jesus himself, our Lord and King, said, a prophet is not without honor except in his own house among his own kin. Get it? He's the God man. And his people didn't believe in him till after the resurrection. This kid never sinned in word, thought, or deed. And his brothers and sisters were still going, I changed your diaper. Why did you make that? There's a problem with that chair you just made. No, the chair is perfect. No, you need to. He was raised in a home where they didn't get it, and they didn't get him until later. So don't just because you have children and you serve the Lord does not mean your children are going to choose to walk in your way. There's a very famous evangelist who had a healing ministry. And one line that was spoken about her was, the young girls that ran her office never seemed to feel the need to live a holy life like the leader did, because they just thought she had the ointment on her, that she had the presence on her. Did you know there are people who will serve in a ministry where the person has the excellent character of Samuel, but they will not follow morally? They won't. No, that's normal. If you don't know that's normal, you're going to have a false sense of responsibility to preach or manipulate or control to get your kids, you know, whatever it is they're into, to get them out of it. Now, I'm saying be a straight stick. Just be a good example, and God has to move on the hearts of family. Come on, we all have family members that do not follow God at all, nor have any interest in it, and they've got one foot in the grave, one foot in a banana peel, and we're always conflicted. It's like, what? You know, famous preachers have problems with their children. I know them. They don't talk about it in public, but every famous preacher has some kid that's crazy, worshiping the devil in their room. You know, some kind of thing that you go, what? Billy Graham had trouble in his family. It wasn't to that extent, but he had trouble. You're human. Your commitments cannot be, through osmosis, the brother Moses passed on to everybody in your house. So just calm down. You don't need to win them. No one died and left you Holy Ghost. There's a shirt, Gretchen. It wouldn't mention a cat in it, but it would probably inform the people. What's stopping me from putting these glasses on? I don't like that, what I'm feeling right now. Okay. It's coming from the back of the room to my right. Listen to this. Samuels choose to maintain their character, and they finish well. That's as rare as hen's teeth. They maintain their character. They finish well. Others may. You may not. So it's not being legalistic. Man, they're so legalistic, you know. You know, I smoked 3 packs a day for 10 years. And I thought it was a sign of spiritual maturity that I was not under the fleshly bondage of immature brethren, and I could exercise my liberty. If I would have kept it up, I would be going, now in my neck, oh, open the Bible to the Book of Wonder. You know, no. Well, by the grace of God, that was the hardest thing ever put down in my life, ever. It wasn't the nicotine, it was the ritual. It's like after everybody shut up and left me alone, I'd go out and have my cigarette, all right? I was never going to quit that. I told God, if you tell me to quit, I'm going to double up on what I'm doing. That was our understanding.
Why, that doesn't sound appropriate.
Well, I tell you the truth. I could lie to you and say an angel came down and delivered me. Born again, do you smoke? Get him out, you know. And he is safely in heaven, praise be to God. 93 years old, Ernest Angley, right there. There's something about others may, you may not, that God will get to you. He will. He will. But, you know, I thought, hey, I'm a normal guy, and I'm hanging out with the people, so God can use a normal guy. So, but you know what? It was the dumbest thing I could have ever thought of doing, trying to pretend that was liberty and that was maturity versus these immature people who are going, there's a cloud, but it wasn't the glory cloud. You're not kidding. I was immature, you know? But God knows the difference between rebellion and immaturity. I was horribly immature, but he knew it wasn't rebellion. And he delivered me of that by his grace. When Grant was born, it just somehow, I don't know, I'd smoke with a patch on. You know what I mean? There was no way I was giving that up. And some of you may feel you have one of those categories in your life. Did you know Jesus is more than able to come in and empathize and pull the pin out of that thing and bring you deliverance? And these Samuels we're going to see are going to carry that kind of power around without shaming people. People don't need a lecture. They need deliverance. You know, they don't need, well, now your lungs are black like these lungs. I saw the lungs at the middle school presentation bus. Remember when they'd bring you through and show you cancer, black lungs? Remember? They'd go, now, here's a healthy lung. Ooh, ooh. Here's a rotten lung of Craig Johnson. You know, it's like, oh, God. Do you want that lung, little baby? No, please, no. Do we have to eat the lung? No, you don't eat it. It's to show you that you shouldn't do that. It's bad. Okay, that doesn't stop anyone from anything. You just get better at hiding. You just hide the bottles better. Mm-hmm. We found the bottle in midair in between. It was upside. You just hide better, right? Preaching doesn't do it. No one died and left you Holy Ghost, but the power of God can help you exchange that. You know how we say when you have a dog and he has a bone and it's all he's got, if you try to grab that, he'll take your arm off. Just put a piece of prime rib down. He'll have the idea to drop the bone. That's how you debone a dog. That's worth the whole offering right there. Okay, moving on. Samuels have unusual combinations of hats and offices. God's Samuels that are coming up right now, oh, my Lord, they're going to start popping up like popcorn. They're like the 7,000 that haven't bowed a knee to Baal or kissed his mouth. They're hidden right now. But when they pop up, look at Samuel. Number one, he was a Nazarite. Do you know what that was in Numbers chapter 6? This was a child dedicated to utter separation to the things of God. And there was another Nazarite he was in ministry with, Samson. Remember? Never cut his hair, never ate fermented fruits, never drank wine, never. And so the Bible says Hannah put a Nazarite vow on her baby. She said, a razor will never touch his head. And he picked that up when he came of age and said, I'm taking mama's vow and I'm living this out to the last of my days. You could see him coming with his hair. There's Samuel. And the Bible says when he would come to a town, the elders' knees would start wrapping together because they knew anything he said was going to happen. And they would greet him with this. Is it well? Man of God, remember he comes into Bethlehem to anoint David. They say, is it well? Are we good? Are we good? Because any prophetic arrow he shoots is going to hit the bullseye. It's going to happen. So if he says, and by the way, do you know the first word he had to give when he was about 13 years old? First word was to Eli to tell him he and his sons were going to die. No way to reverse it. His priesthood would be rooted out forever. And this kid is 13 or 14, right? How do you tell your daddy, you're all going to die? Beautiful word, daddy. You're all dead. Hallelujah. I never did hear my new prophetic words like that. Have you ever noticed? Samuel had such an accuracy rate that he is another trait of Samuel. He was a leader of leaders. The Samuels coming up are leaders of leaders. He had a school of the prophets, so he was leading younger people. But here's a better point. You ready? You're ready for this. It's a heavy revy. He was a leader of leaders of leaders because he was a king maker and a king breaker. He had such an anointing that God used him. Here he is, Mr. In-Between. He is the last of the judges, the first of the prophets, and the kingmaker who's going to come up and literally anoint the whole next move of redemptive history that's going to be 40 years of Saul, 40 years of David, 40 years of Samuel, and is going to go on. It's going to go from bad to worse, but it's going to go on to the last kings. Well, this guy had the juice. This guy had the anointing. This guy had the stuff. And he wasn't Samson, Rufus Glitterteeth. He wasn't all power gifts, but he finished well. And as long as he lived, and notice something about Samuel, there was something about his actual presence wherever he went. God was with him, through him, to the people. He had a ministry that his presence, his physical presence, meant something. When he went to Gilgal, boom. The prophet's here because the glory just fell on the city. When he went to Bethel, boom, the glory was there. Did you know that the ministry of Catherine Kuhlman, this was her pulpit, when Catherine's car tires went underground to the garage at the Shrine Auditorium, as soon as her vehicle came on the property, people started getting healed outside. They've been waiting from 4 or 5 in the morning till 1 o'clock when the doors open. The blind people would just start getting healed. Her proximity in a space, they didn't know she was there. God knew she was there. And whenever Samuel walked up, a double dose of the Holy Ghost from coast to coast. And it wasn't a charismatic, it wasn't loud. It was a still reality. You know, I've been telling you, the power that's coming is going to be quiet power. The snow that falls all night, not making a sound, bows down the strongest tree without a sound. The dew watering the entire earth every day without a sound. The sun warming the earth every day without a sound. Solomon's temple rising stone by stone without a sound. There's a holy hush that's coming to the world. And it's not the earthquake, and it's not the fire, and it's not loud, but it's real. I want the real. I don't care how long I have to wait. I don't care how much I do my circuit and do the next right thing. Remember, John the Baptist only had about 6 months of ministry, but John the Baptist also was an in-between man. Look at him. All the Old Testament prophets on one side, the kingdom of God and the advent of the God-man on the other. John was in between, and he didn't last too long. In between. But his 6 to 12 months of ministry, rich and delicious and sweet. Aren't you willing to wait? Good things come to those who wait. Oh, I want to encourage all my Samuels watching right now. You said, I think I'm a Samuel. I think you are too. But look at his offices. He was a Nazirite, uniquely set apart for God's work. He was the last judge in the series of the judges, the best and finest, like the best wine saved to last. He also, because he stood in between the judges and the kings, he was that scribe of the kingdom, Jesus said. The scribe of the kingdom can take from the old and the new and mix them together and bring truth forth. He was a scribe of the kingdom, standing between the judges and the kingship of God. What a gift, this guy. He was the linchpin of the hinge that tied the past and the future together. Little linchpins. My Samuel linchpins, that's what you are. You're the one who holds those hinges together. He was a Levite. That means he would have priestly sympathies, a priestly eye, ear, mouth, heart, and touch. In fact, he was an expert in sacrificial law and was absolutely necessary to be present at every sacrifice. Did you know Samuel had to be at every sacrifice to make sure it was done right because Eli and his sons had screwed it up so bad they even lost the ark, these fools. So after 20 years, Samuel's going to make sure things are done right. And you did not have the freedom to make a sacrifice. And we see Saul, the first king, was a fool. Samuel says to Saul, oh, by the way, can I read something? I'm winding down, but I got to labor with you on one point. And let me just, I've got to read this for you to get the impact of it. This is Betty's Bible, Tom. I brought Betty O'Neill's Bible today, and it had extra power in it. I want you to listen. When he anoints Saul, the first king of Israel, listen to his gift. Then Samuel took a vial of oil, and he poured it upon his head and kissed him and said, is it not because the Lord has anointed you to be captain over his inheritance? Verse 3 says, then shalt thou go on forward from thence and come to the plain of Tabor, and there you shall meet three men going up to God to Bethel, one carrying three kids, another carrying three loaves of bread, and another carrying a bottle of wine. And they will salute thee and give thee two loaves of bread, which thou shalt receive of their hands. After that, thou shalt come to the hill of God, where is the garrison of the Philistines, and it shall come to pass when thou art come thither to the city, that thou shalt meet a company of prophets coming down from the high place with a psaltery and a tabret and pipe and harp before them, and they shall prophesy. Verse 6, and the Spirit of the Lord will come upon thee, and thou shalt prophesy with them, and shalt be turned into another man. Verse 7, and let it be when these signs have come unto you that you do as occasion serve thee, for the Lord is with thee. You think Samuel had a detailed prophetic ministry? Did you see those details? How could he know? He didn't send them. Oh, well, he paid them in advance. No, he knows the future. He's a seer. He's not just a prophet, a forth teller of God's word. He's a seer, a chazan, which is a foreteller. Remember, Saul's donkeys are lost, and go to the seer. Go to Samuel. He knows where your asses are. It's true. And they say, do you have any money? He goes, yeah, we got a Finsky. We got a $5 bill. We'll just give that to. And they go up because this man is so accurate in the acknowledged by the whole nation. That not one spear doesn't hit the bullseye, not one arrow doesn't hit the bullseye. Won't that be a fun time coming up? Not misfiring every other prophecy. Not someone saying to me, Pastor Glenn, come up here. I remember Cardinal Spellman was the cardinal that friends with the Kennedy family back in the 60s. They asked Cardinal Spellman once what he thought of papal infallibility, and he said, well, he always calls me Spillman. There are some Christians that believe God, even God, can't know the future because the future doesn't exist yet, so God's guesstimating, but he's just better at it than we are. Hello, what about this? That's accuracy, beloved. That's like three guys and this and then three loaves, they're going to give you two, and bada boom it, and when all these signs have passed, God's going to come upon you and turn you into another man. Ooh. Don't you love accurate words, not the vague ones? You know, I might have to just mention another little text. My Samuels are eating this up. You're putting this on a plate and sopping it up with a biscuit, so I'm preaching to you today. 1 Samuel 3:19 says, and Samuel grew, and the Lord was with him, and let none of his words fall to the ground. And all Israel, from Dan even to Beersheba, knew that Samuel was established to be a prophet. And the Lord appeared again unto Shiloh, for the Lord revealed himself to Samuel by the word of the Lord. It says the word of the Lord was absent in those days. It wasn't being taught properly. It wasn't present. And by the way, I mentioned Samuels always have cherished intercessors. Listen to his mama after she gets her prayer answered. And Hannah prayed and said, my heart rejoiceth in the Lord. Mine horn is exalted in the Lord, and my mouth is enlarged over my enemies, because I rejoice in thy salvation. There is none holy as the Lord, for there is none beside thee. Neither is there any rock like our God. Talk no more so exceedingly proud. Let not arrogancy come out of your mouth, for the Lord is the God of knowledge, and by him actions are weighed. The bows of the mighty men are broken, and they that stumbled are girded with strength. They that were full have hired themselves out for bread, and they that were hungry have ceased, so that the barren hath more, hath borne seven, and she that hath many children is waxed feeble. The Lord killeth and maketh alive. He bringeth down to the grave and bringeth up. The Lord maketh poor and maketh rich. He bringeth low and lifteth up. He raiseth up the poor out of the dust and lifteth up the beggar from the dunghill, to set them among princes and to make them inherit the throne of glory, for the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and he hath set the world upon them. He will keep the feet of his saints, and the wicked shall be silent in darkness. You want that woman praying for you? That's a Thor hammer right there. She knows the whole history of her people. She knows the word of God. She has the anointing of the Holy Ghost. And it says that she prayed for him. Every year she would come up and bring a new mantle of linen that would, because he had been growing. And she was his biggest fan, biggest supporter. And when you know mama's praying, everything's going to be all right. When Michael was in trouble, I only called a few people to pray. I didn't call the snoozers. I called folk like Hannah. Her name meant grace. She was gracious. But she's praying for her baby. His ministry lasted 80 years. Mama's storming the gates. Samuels, don't worry, you're going to have intercessors. You're not in this alone. It's not a cult. You're going to have folk supporting you, fellow Samuels, that can bless you and lift you up and encourage you and help you bear all of your mantles. He's a Nazarite. He's a Levite. He's a prophet, a foreteller. He's a seer, a foreteller, and he's an intercessor of immense power. And this was his greatest gift, because he was a friend of God. The Bible says, remember? He calls the nation up and says, repent, throw away your false gods. Baal, Ashtaroth, Baal and Ashtaroth. Baal was the fertility god, and Ashtaroth was his mistress. So in order to incite them to mate so there'd be fruitful land, they would go in and have ritual sex with a prostitute and hope that that would incite their lust to get busy so the land would be fruitful. This is a corrupt gang. And Samuel goes, how about not doing that anymore? He's so legalistic. I mean, you know, this is America. I can do whatever I want. He calls them together. But here's the thing. He's up on a mountaintop ready to give a burnt offering, and the entire Philistine army, tens of thousands, come up while he's calmly up on top of the hill. And the children of Israel go, could you intercede for us right now before the Lord, lest we die? And he's just calmly making the sacrifice. He's got it now. And it says, it thundered. God caused the elements themselves to break out against this innumerable army and scared the business out of them. And they were confused, and they turned and ran, and the children of Israel got to follow after them. And, you know, he always lets you throw a rock. Yeah, don't come back. I'm talking to you. You don't want none of this. You know, oh, Lord God. Remember, even the hailstones came out of heaven. The valley where Joshua fought. Remember? Sisera's chariots, 900 of them. It says the stars in their courses, the elements themselves fought against Sisera and gummed those chariots up in water and mud. Don't be afraid, beloved, because the Lord is with you. They can come right up to your hula hoop you're standing in, but they cannot reach in and touch you. And Samuel's cool. I love him. It's good. It's all good. And as soon as he offers that blood sacrifice, the elements break out against the enemy. We're going to see some unusual signs and wonders with God's Samuels. You know, well, if I saw a leg growing, I'd believe. No, you wouldn't. No, you wouldn't. You'd say it's an anomaly that we'll understand someday when E.T. comes back. Mm-hmm. Don't play. Jesus said, if you don't believe Moses and the prophets right now, you would not believe if one were to rise from the dead. Don't deceive yourself. The people who see the signs and wonders as from God are people that have a heart for God, and they're thirsty and hungry, and they know his ways. We're going to see some extravagant signs and wonders. I'm up. Count me in. I don't have to be used to do them. I just want to be in the front row with popcorn. We're going to see it. And who cares who gets to be used? I just want to be in the room. An intercessor of immense power. And I told you, he was a leader of leaders. He had school of the prophets, but he was a leader of leaders of leaders. A kingmaker. And I'm ending with what I find one of the most beautiful truths I've made the truth a number of times. I have shared this with you a number of times, but today it bears repetition. Samuel was obedient to God in every little detail that was revealed to him. The scripture says that he anointed Saul with a flask, pak, a man-made vessel. Same oil on Saul and David, different vessel of delivery. Saul would turn out to be the leader of the flesh, the man-made leader the people wanted in their flesh. And so he was anointed with a man-made flask. When David was anointed, it says he took a keren, a horn, a living, something from a living thing, a God-made thing that had been brought to that spot through sacrifice and death and shed blood. But it was a God-made container because David was God's made king. Saul didn't last because flesh doesn't last. But he had to hear that closely, because if you don't hear details correctly, you mess up a type of Christ. Remember Moses and Aaron? Were not allowed into the promised land because what did they do? They struck the rock. That's not the type of Christ. He wasn't struck twice. But they screwed up a type of the Messiah, and God would not let them go in to the promised land because that little, it was a little inconvenience. God, don't be so anal. What's the matter with you? I mean, the guy's been faithful most of it. No, his refusal to speak to the rock ruined a type of the Messiah that we can't use now in the New Testament. You know what? This guy was willing to hear, yeah, it's the same oil, but anoint him, pour that oil into a flask, because this man's not going to last. He's got a flask anointing. Notice he was anointed with a flask, and he went right from his home to the throne. Some anointings only get you raised up real quick, a height from which you're going to fall. You know, during war, there are things called wartime commissions. Like, everybody's dead but you, and so they promote you to be the lieutenant for 20 minutes. So there's a laying on of hands because you're all they got. But, you know, during peacetime, they're going to lay their hands off of you because you were never meant to be a lieutenant. He can strike a straight blow with a crooked stick. Samuel was able to hear, use a flask because he's man-made, okay? And go fill your horn with oil and go to the house of Jesse and anoint David, because he's a God-made man. He's my man. He went, okay. Aren't you glad he wasn't hearing vague? Well, just anoint him. Put it in the bucket and bring it in. He would have screwed up a type of that God is trying to delineate. That's why when the Holy Spirit anoints you, perhaps to give a word or encouragement to someone, don't interpret it, give it. I see a piece of Swiss cheese on a piece of toast. If that's all you get, give it. Don't interpret it. And the cheese, of course, always represents dairy products. Do what he said. Let them interpret it. It'll make sense to them. And by the way, the first word he gave to Eli was, you're all going to die. And you know what's interesting? The scripture says Eli had already heard this. God's never going to send people to you outright to tell you anything other than to confirm what you already know. Some other nameless, faceless prophet had come to Eli and said, you're toast, you're all going to die, we're going to root up your priestly family. He'd heard it already. Samuel confirmed it. 14-year-old, 13-year-old confirmed it. Whew. So, it's going to get rich. And communitas is the key. Can you imagine all these Samuels that are being raised up now? When they see one another, when in between people meet, that communitas, that Latin word for that unmistakable bond. Brian gave me a beautiful quote from Ken Burns' Civil War series. It's Oliver Wendell Holmes who says, of that time. We have shared the incommunicable experience of war. We have felt and still feel the passion of life to its top. In our youths, our hearts were touched with fire. That's communitas. That's that bond that you have with people that have gone through the same in-between time as you, and you see each other, and you empathize with one another, and you know when you meet, like the hobbits after their journey. They're sitting in the same pub, but they've had a different experience. They have communitas. The others are just drunk. They don't even understand. And it's so deep, you can't explain it. You can't do a PowerPoint explanation. Now, the rest of you is just drunk. We're here. Let us show with the PowerPoint what we've been... Communitas is caught, not taught. It sneaks up on you, and it hallows your connection. And all I can tell you is, Samuels, welcome. Welcome. Put a welcome mat out. Maybe God wants you to encourage some Samuels. You'll run into them. Support them. Pray for them. Financially support. Feed them. If they feed you and you're hopeful about their future, feed them. Take care of them. Nurture them. Acknowledge them. Because Jesus said, if you give a cup of water to a prophet, you get his entire reward. What? Yeah. If you supported Billy Graham with $1, you get his whole reward for his entire ministry. Well, I like that multiplication. So do I. That's why in the Garden of Eden, the devil said, God didn't want you to eat that tree. He's holding out on you. He's stingy, Eve. Oh, he's letting you eat the whole universe except that one tree. But, you know, he's afraid that you... God is not stingy, beloved. He is extravagant in his generosity. So give me a cup of water before I leave the building. I want to bless you, every one of you. You say, Craig, I don't know if I'm a Samuel. Yes, you are. If you're alive and you're still sucking air... I have a friend that said, how you doing? They said, I'm on the right side of the grass. That's the way to look at it. If God was finished with you, you would be gone. But you're still here because your character is forged for this hour. Your gifts, the mini hats you wear are going to bless people in this hour. You've had to wait a long time, but it's worth the wait. Father, we thank you for this day. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all in the upper room in one accord. And it says, suddenly there was a sound of a rushing mighty wind. God, I pray right now, suddenly there would be a rush of mighty wind upon my precious brethren right now, that you would refresh them, that you would fill them from the top of their head to the soles of their feet with a new baptism of the Holy Ghost. Father, right now, fill your vessels, cleanse your vessels, anoint your vessels, Lord. We are going to participate with these Samuels. Either we're one, or we're praying for them, or we're enjoying the show, sitting comfortably in the front row. Father, thank you for the Samuels in between. Bless them, encourage them, support them, refresh them, heal them, deliver them, anything they need to stay alive, any circularity in their circuit that they need to do. Keep doing the next right thing before your reformation comes. It's coming. Your revival is coming. Your reformation is coming, and you're going to be glad that you waited, and you're going to be glad that you're the age that you are right now with the wisdom and the character God has woven into you. I bless the Samuels in the name of Jesus on this holy day. Someone say amen. Give some praise to the Lord if you can. Give him some praise. We bless you. We love you. We are encouraging you. Samuel, that's who you are. See? Start meditating on this. And by the way, you go to the website that Mike runs so excellently. Can we give love to Mike Fuller? Say thank you, Mike. Mike runs the whole thing. He's like the Holy Ghost. He's behind the scenes. You go to every message. The sermon notes are written there for you. So, I mean, don't reinvent the wheel. Go and click on them, and you will see the information. Stick it on the fridge. Soak in it. All these Samuel points are yours from the hand of the Lord. So God's peace on you. We love you. If you have any prayer requests, send them in. We want you to be encouraged and refreshed. It's all going to make sense, and you're going to be glad that you waited this long. Amen. God bless you.
We hope today's message has been a blessing to you. And if it has, please visit our website at drcraigjohnson.org. There you can find additional messages of encouragement. And if our ministry has been a blessing to you, please consider us in your ministry giving, as we depend solely on the financial assistance of our listeners like yourself. Also, please feel free to send any personal prayer requests. You can find us online at drcraigjohnson.org. God bless you.